Friday.
And
they're gonna catch all of
it.
So weird.
Talk about Minecraft.
Who's preaching today? I'm sorry.
That dude, Dougie. Play it. Play
yes.
it. Play it.
Look at
them. Play
look
it.
Look at
them. AJ, are you preaching tonight?
Who's preaching?
I think it's Miss Noelle.
It's who?
Miss Noelle.
The other day.
I'm pretty sure it's
Shrek. I'm looking down.
God
look
bless.
Down.
I'm
okay.
So excited.
So we're playing Minecraft, right?
Shrek.
And
looking down.
Traversing deeper and deeper into that mine right by our house. And you know how there's the ravine? I finally found like a surefire way to get to the ravine every time. So like, you know.
We made some serious progress.
So we were like past the ravine. We're just so deep in. We found diamonds.
They are. It's okay. They can rewatch it.
Union Day.
You know, we found diamond, and I had 8 diamonds because I found like a good vein.
Oh no!
And I had a ton of redstone and gold and iron, and I was so mad, right? And we had melon seeds. We need the melon seeds. And so what happens is that I'm mining for redstone, right?
Which I want because I want to make.
My hands raising.
Right? And it wasn't like mining directly underneath me, but like I guess I moved a little bit too far forward. I fall and lava starts seeping into the hole I fall into.
Oh, nice.
And it was too late for me.
She lost all the diamonds.
That's tragic.
A little bit of the iron made it onto like the ground and not into the lava, but.
The worst part is that Isabel had to call me into where she was. Because she was fighting like 2 different skeleton spawners.
Mm-hmm.
And so like we got past the skeleton
spawners. Time to go, isn't it?
There were no more mobs in there. We were just gathering like
3 minutes and yeah, it is time to go.
There was like a whole bunch of mobs scattered around.
It's literally
every second
and I left.
Every
single
second.
Oh yeah? Oh yeah?
And she's like, yeah, so I'm dying.
Okay.
No.
I should have just left. After I got those diamonds, I should have just left because my inventory was so full.
That's significantly worse than that time when I hit Link in the lava. I promise.
I was so mad, man.
I have full armor, so now I'm an armed tree.
I'm an armed potted plant.
Imagine being killed.
I'm a whole area. Yeah,
imagine dying and then coming back and then getting brutally murdered by an armed potted plant.
You right?
Wait, what?
Yeah.
Oh, hey, AJ. Can you
AJ
hear?
AJ Winters, are you watching?
Hey, AJ, can you hear us?
Morning, Liz. Where are you sitting at? Your normal seat?
Yeah.
Morning, Liz.
I'm holding your ear. Does that make
how you guys doing?
Gary.
I think I'm hearing. I'm holding his ear.
Yeah, but
I think I'm an earring. This takes the call by
I feel like this is one of those instances, you know where they tag the cow.
No, I'm not learning it, is he?
Big tag.
So. Hey, Ty learned it.
Yeah.
So did Kaylin.
Are you really calling yourself?
I'm cattle.
The best
ear. Tired. I'm calling myself a sheep.
You're a teenager, that's how. I am so excited. Who's preaching?
Miss Noelle.
Oh, hold up, I gotta check my Pokemons.
Pokemon.
Did you get the new iOS update?
I didn't see anything.
They have dark mode now. For iOS, it's iOS 13, so instead of everything being like lighter colors, like the menu, it's dark. You can set it up to be dark.
No, I'm on.
Which is good because
it's always existed.
So I don't blind.
No, they just added it to 13.
Dang it,
no.
I don't have
like,
that.
No, you've always been able to adjust the brightness, but there's actually a dark mode. Now it's time
not
to
not.
All right, kiddo, let's go.
Do not call me a kiddo. I'm older than you. I am 18.
I'm sitting over here. Okay, so you want to sit here.
You're
okay. I'm
still
sitting here.
Such a
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
How you guys doing this morning? I think it's finally fall.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. Hey, thanks. Appreciate that. How's everybody doing?
Good.
Well, welcome.
Welcome.
That's a wonderful word. We do that, doesn't it? God, we just thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to gather in your house. God, thank you for getting us all here safely. Father, I pray that you would have your way with this service. God, that you would touch and each and every single one of that. Each and every single person as up on the platform. Father, that you would open up every single one of our hearts and to receive from you this morning, Lord. I don't really know what you got planned today, God, but I'm excited to find out. We're excited to be in your presence. So, Father, have your way with the service, have your way in our lives. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. May people in here know that we serve an undefeated God.
Amen.
God that has not lost, will not ever lose. Isn't that exciting?
Amen.
All right, can we stand up and can we give him praise this morning? Thank you.
October 8th is the morning Bible study on Tuesdays. It starts at 10. And on the 9th, we're going to have another meeting for the trick-or-treat outreach downtown at Wayne Shop. And that'll begin at 6 o'clock. Our Outer Banks retreat is coming up from October 11th through the 21st. Pastor Carrie has more information. She'll be getting out to you today. And then on October 12th is Super Saturday. It's going to be downtown at Trinity United Methodist Church. And Sister Judy Horn is going to need help because the women will be down at the beach. On Friday, what time?
At 9 o'clock in the morning. I appreciate anyone. Actually, I'm saying that the women are retreating, so I need the men to come forward and help make the clam chowder.
And so where will you be
sure they can, I'm sure they can handle it very well. Thank you.
And she'll be here. So, and if you're a woman that is not going, you can also help her out. So we know men can do this. Okay, and then on the 23rd, we're going to have another meeting, so we're going to miss one Wednesday in between because we're going to be at the beach. So the 23rd will be our final meeting. And then on the 30th, we're going to have our Unite on Wednesday night. We're going to be doing that every fifth Wednesday. And we're going to have a campfire. We're going to do some worship out there. So bring your whole family. Everybody is invited. And we're going to have, and then the 31st, we're going to do the Halloween outreach down there. We need candy. Lots of candy. There's like 3,000 people downtown. So times that by a couple pieces, so we need lots of candy. So there's a little box out there. Fill it up so we can empty it and fill it up again. We have a Roar Women's Conference on March 27th through 28th. There'll be more information coming out. There's also a little flyer out on the table out there in the hallway. So be sure to get one of those. So then you'll know all about that. And right now we're going to play a little video on Christmas shoebox.
As long as it's enclosed like a compact mirror. Glass, No. Superheroes? Yes. Camouflage items. If the child can wear or use the items without looking like a soldier, they are okay to include in your shoebox gift. Bright or colored camouflage is safe, as are pencils, wallets, or socks. Saws and knives, or multi-tools with knives? No. No kind of knives except butter knives are allowed. Squirt guns. These can be included as long as they do not look like real guns. Seeds? No. Batteries? Yes. But if they are loose, cover both ends with tape. Paint sets or glue bottles? No. Both of these items are liquids and can't be included in your shoebox gifts. However, dry paint sets, such as watercolors or glue sticks, are okay to pack. Remember, always refer to our official inappropriate items list at SamaritansPurse.org/OCC when sharing whether something can or cannot be packed in a shoebox gift. When sharing what not to pack, stick to the guidelines, not personal preference, and no shoebox shaming. Our official list is no candy, toothpaste, gum, used or damaged items, war-related items, seeds, food, liquids or lotions, medications or vitamins, breakable items or glass, or aerosol cans. To see what to pack instead, check out our gift suggestions by age and gender at SamaritansPurse.org/OCC.
Operation Shoebox is a wonderful ministry, and they have it now where you can actually track your package and see where it ends up. On December 14th, we're going to be taking a group of people. We're going to be leaving at 4:30 in the morning. We're going to be taking people and inspecting and packing and praying over these boxes. So Lisa told me that it's an experience that you'll never forget. So mark that on your calendars. It's a 6-hour shift. It starts at 9, and then they'll be heading back afterwards. So with all that, that's the end of our announcements. We'll go ahead and take our tithes and offerings.
I confess your word over these tithes and offerings. As I do this, I say with my mouth and believe in my heart that your word will not return to you void, but will accomplish what you say it will. Therefore, I believe in the name of Jesus that all my needs are met. Because I am a tither and a giver, the increase is given to me. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Because my harvest depends upon what I sow, I am abundantly blessed and walk in the favor of God.
Faith, will you pray?
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for our wonderful pastors and for my mom who's preaching today. You do a great job. You've been over this 1,000 times, and let this whole day be great. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Hey guys, I got one more thing on Operation Christmas Child. You can sit down real quick. Just a reminder, those little plastic totes run out quick. And we're kind of ahead of the curve, so get out and buy them at the dollar store or whatever. They work better than a shoebox. The shoeback size plastic totes with the cover. So those work real good, and then they got a container to keep afterwards. So, but they go fast. So I know Walmart has them, Dollar Store has them, Dollar General has them. So get them and purchase them and buy some extra ones in case somebody doesn't get one, because they'll be sold out in about 2 weeks. So.
If you participated in the youth rally, let's just look up here again, whether you're out there or okay. All right. So I'm going to give you a hand. They did a great job. They did a great job. It was good.
service really touched my heart up specifically. And I preached a short little message, and I don't exactly know why, but I really feel God pressing on my heart that we need to do that song again this morning. And I'm just going to start, preface this, and then be able to start playing his level keys there. Luke chapter 5 is the story of Jesus and the miracle with the fish, right? Are you guys familiar with that story? So basically, there Jesus was on the beach, and he was preaching, and he was preaching, and people just started to gravitate toward him on the beach. And he sees Simon and James and John come in from the sea, and they had just were fishing, and he's preaching his message, and then he gets in Simon's boat, and he starts preaching from the boat, and eventually, after he's done preaching, he says to Simon, "Hey, let's go out in your boat, and let's go back out fishing." And you know, I can just imagine Simon and his friends. They were just out all night long fishing. They're professional fishermen. It's what they do for their living. It's how they make their money. It's how they provide food for their families. It's their livelihood. It's their 9 to 5. Except that I'm sure they did a lot more than 40 hours a week. And then Jesus says, "Hey, let's go back out." Even though he didn't catch anything, and I can just imagine Simon being, "Jesus, are you nuts? Like, we're exhausted. We're professional fishermen. We've been out all night. We didn't catch anything. There's no fish in this sea." And we would, of all people, know this because this is what we do every single day. I fish these waters every day. But, you know, Simon said something that I think we can all learn from. He says, "You know, Jesus, because you said so, we'll go out again. And we'll try again." And that really just speaks volumes to me, because it didn't make any logical sense for Simon and James and John to go back out there with Jesus. It made no logical sense. They've been out there all night. They didn't catch anything. There's no fish out there. No logical sense whatsoever. It was also a tremendous inconvenience for them as well. Why? Because they were out all night long. They're exhausted and ready to go home. The passage says that they were out all night. So it's tremendously inconvenient for them. They're exhausted. They're ready to go home. They have zero interest in going back out in that water and being part of Jesus' sermon illustration. But he says, "Because you said so, Jesus, we'll go back out. Because you said so." Now, I mentioned Sunday night, you know, I could preach a whole sermon series on that line right there. "Jesus, because you said so, we'll go back out." But the story doesn't end there. We know that they go out in the boat, and Jesus blesses them and fills their nets with fish, and then they pull them into the boat, and the boat begins to sink. So much so that they had to bring out another boat, and then they filled that boat, and it began to sink. You guys realize how much fish has to be in a fishing boat to sink that sucker? A lot of fish. I can't even begin to comprehend it, but this is a boat that's designed to hold, I don't know, I've never seen a picture of them, I don't know how big they are, but they're designed to hold plenty of people. I can just imagine this boat is probably filled at least 10 to 12 feet with fish. It starts to literally sink down in the water. And everybody's amazed, of course. Jesus just performed a miracle. It's amazing. People are awestruck. That's what happens when miracles happen. It takes our breath away. So that's really, really awesome. And I could preach a whole other sermon series about Jesus' wonderful blessings whenever we obey him. But the story doesn't end there. But the story ends in verse 11. It talks about after all of the people, Simon and his friends included, but all the people were amazed. And after they got their bearings, after they started to come back down to earth, they started to head back into shore. And it says, as soon as they reached the shore, Simon, James, and John, they dropped everything and then they followed Jesus. So I'm gonna ask you guys the same question that I asked the Sunday night crowd. What does that include? What did they leave behind? And if you were here Sunday night, I don't want anybody to answer. If you weren't here Sunday night, I want to hear from you. So just slip your hand up or just shout it out. I don't care. What did they leave behind? Since they dropped everything and they left, what does that include? What did they leave? Yep. Left their family. Their homes. Anybody else? Yeah, their everyday life. Their life obviously changes course.
Their jobs.
So they were fishermen, right? So they left all of their fishing equipment, right? Left their jobs completely. What else did they leave?
Security.
What do you mean by that?
They left what they knew.
Right. They left what they knew to go out and enter the. Anybody else?
Fish.
Yes. Tons and tons and tons and tons and tons of fish that they just pulled up out of that water. They left what Jesus just blessed them with. Great job, Isabel. I know she was here Sunday, she cheated, but it's okay. You see, the story teaches, hey, obey Jesus no matter what. It doesn't make any logical sense. It's not convenient for us. Obey Jesus anyway. Yes, Jesus. Yes, sir. And go. It teaches us that. It also teaches us that when we obey, he's going to bless us abundantly. Yes. But the whole premise of the story was that nothing on this earth can possibly compare to being in the presence of God. Nothing else matters. Nothing. Not your job, not your family, not the life as you know it. Nothing matters. Not even Jesus' abundant blessings in your life. None of it matters. When you're sold out for God, you understand that that doesn't matter. Nothing matters. You pack up everything without even questioning it, and you leave and you follow him for the sole purpose of just being in his presence, listening to him, talking with him, fellowshipping with him, eating with him, just spending time in the presence of God. That's the whole premise of the story. Verse 12 goes and talks about he was healing one of the many women in the Bible. I can't remember. That's not the point. The point is, that's the end of the story. The whole premise of the story was to get us to understand, as readers of the Word of God, to understand that, hey, none of that matters. Literally, the previous 11 verses, none of it matters because they left. They left it all to go follow Jesus. And that's not to say that you don't obey God. That's not to say that you don't appreciate his blessings. Did you guys pick it up and put it down here? So, we sang this song that it's called Nothing Else. And I love this song because it brings us back to the whole idea of Christianity. The whole reason that we do this, that we put on this, for lack of a better term, the reason we put on this show on Sunday morning is it's not to get anything out of it. It's just to honor God and to worship him. That's the whole reason I'm here. I don't know about you guys. If we weren't worshiping God, if we weren't honoring God, in spite of whatever circumstances that we're facing in our day, that I wouldn't be here. I'm here to worship God. So my question is, what are you here for this morning? I pray that this morning that you have a come to Jesus moment and you realize, hey, you speak to us in a very specific, intentional way this morning. unlike we've never experienced before. Father, I thank you for being in this place. Holy Spirit's here, God. Father, I thank you for being in this place. I thank you for being faithful and showing up here on a week-to-week basis, really on a day-to-day basis. Father, I pray that we would not miss that this morning. I pray that if we're here this morning and we have something's not lining up in our life, Lord, I pray that we would come to terms with it, and we would come to terms with you, Lord, and we would put that down, and we would take up our cross, and we would follow you, and drop everything this morning, and we would follow you, I pray. Have your way with this service, God. Open up our hearts. Help us to hear from you this morning. In Jesus' name.
sowing, you're not planting seed into the soil if you're not. For example, these young ladies and young men up here are planting seed in their music ministry. Right? Young people in the Lord who have a gifting, they're planting that gift in the soil, trusting God to let it rain and for them to grow into worship leaders and worship musicians and some of them even beyond that. So that's what they're sowing. They're taking their giftings or whatever and planting it into the ground and trusting God's going to let it rain on them. But if you haven't planted anything, you're not going to care if it rains. There's no seed in the ground, there's nothing to grow, and you're not going to care if it rains. I thought that was really powerful. So this next time, this next song we're going to sing is this is an interesting one. Okay, I'm just going to be upfront and honest with you. Last night I couldn't sleep. God told me to get up and go to the church, and he wanted me to learn this song for this morning. I've never played this before, and nobody on the platform has heard this song before this morning except myself. So I did something that I've never done before, and I told the worship team, hey, I don't know why, but God said we need to play this song this morning, right now, for a closed service with it. And I'm not sure if any of you have heard this song before, but we're gonna do what God says. And I did something I've never done before, and I trusted these guys further than I've ever trusted them before in A, trusting me that I heard from God, and B, learning this song to be able to do during this worship set right now. Why? Because God said so. It didn't make any logical sense. It was very inconvenient. But because God said so, we're going to do it. The song's called Run to the Father, and this is an opportunity that if you haven't sown seed, that you want to sow seed, you want God to rain on that seed and grow into something that you could never even think or imagine. This is an opportunity for you to say, hey God, I don't want anything else but you. I want to run to you. I want to follow you.
I'm not afraid to
run to the Father, fall into grace, done with the hiding, reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend, and so I run to the Father again and again. And again, and again, and again, and again, and again. Jesus, we're running to you this morning, Lord. We love you. God, we praise you. Steer our hearts in the right direction, Lord. Give us a right track. Get us back on that track that you originally intended, Jesus. Lord, thank you for what you did for us. God, thank you for sending your son. Jesus, thank you for dying on that cross and rising again, giving us all hope. Holy Spirit, thank you for coming down on the day of Pentecost and giving us the power to be able to withstand the attacks from the enemy. Steer us back on track, Lord. I don't have a context for the kind of love that you have. But yet, here we are. Steer us in the right track, Lord. I pray that as we transition to service, God, that you would continue this atmosphere, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would touch and anoint Noelle as she brings the word. God, thank you for her obedience. Lord, I thank you for her sacrifice and her willing to stand bold and do what you said to do. Even though it doesn't make logical sense, maybe, and even though it might not be the most convenient thing, Lord, but because you said so, thank you.
Amen.
To Noelle's obedience. I pray that you would bless us. I pray that your word would flow through her. I thank you for everything that you've done, everything that you're doing in this house and in our house. Lord, we love you. We give you praise, glory, and honor. Thank you for showing up today, God. Help us to not miss you this morning. In Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Santo. Santo, Santo.
Good morning, church family. I love that story, and I love how Pastor Carey tells
She makes it gel, and I love that about her, and I'm thankful for that. And so after God showed me this story over and over and over again, about a week, I knew something was coming. I knew I had to be prepared, and God is such a good God. He knows I don't like surprises, and he knows that I like to be prepared for things, and so I knew something was coming. I didn't know what. And about a week later, I was asked to give the message on Pastor Appreciation Day, no pressure, and I was like, okay, God, you sent me that to encourage me. Thank you so very much. I can do this. And I was like, Lord, please give me a message. I want it to be something really good. I want to honor our pastors. They're such good speakers, and all the guest speakers have been so good, and I want to be good too. And I started praying, and I said, God, please give me a message that's really good. And then he dropped this in my spirit. Oh, wow. There we go. Deuteronomy 31:8. This is in the NIV, and it says, the Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid and do not be discouraged. And once again, I was thinking, oh, thank you, God. That's such an encouragement to me. I'm so thankful that you were telling me I can do this. Please give me a great message. And I prayed the next day, and he didn't give me anything. I still got this verse. And it was then that I started to panic a little bit, and I felt like this.
I'm looking down!
Halfway.
Yeah, but I know that ain't the same.
Okay, fine. I don't have time for this. You go back.
Check the way. Don't do that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Do what? Oh, this?
Yes, that.
Yes? Yes, do it. Okay. That'll do, Donkey. That'll do. Cool.
All right, so I was in a little bit of panic mode, and it was then that I realized that guess who was the donkey in this video? Because I'm stubborn, and I wasn't listening. Even though my word for the year was to listen, I wasn't listening very well. So actually, the verse that God gave me was a verse he wanted me to talk on. And that was confirmed because Jackie, one of my best friends in the world, called me up and she said, I feel like the Lord's supposed to share with me my word for the year with you. And I said, what is it? And she said, be willing. And so then if you put be willing to listen together, it tells me that listening requires some action. It's not just hearing God's word, but it's actually acting on it. So be willing to listen. And so I kind of looked up the other translations of Deuteronomy 31:8, and this is the one that spoke to me, and it's from the New Living Translation, and it says, so be strong and courageous, do not be afraid, and do not panic before them, for the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will never fail you nor abandon you. And that word personally really spoke to me. Our God, this huge God, knows us and will go personally in front of us. And then I got to thinking about the context, because that's the way Pastor Sean has gotten us to think. And I started thinking about the context of this verse. And I realized that this is from Deuteronomy, it's Moses. And he's written this about when they had come out of Egypt, all the Israelites had come out of Egypt, and they were going to take over the promised land. They had been in the desert for 40 years, and Moses was getting up there in years. He's close to 120. God had told him, hey, you're not the guy. You didn't listen to me when you were supposed to speak to the rock. You struck the rock, and you didn't obey me, so you're not the guy. You're not the guy that's going to lead the Israelites into the promised land. Joshua's going to do it. And Moses was about to commission Joshua to take the Israelites into the land he had promised. And I can't help but thinking that Moses and Joshua were probably reflecting as they were facing what was coming, Moses dying, Joshua going into the promised land, that they were reflecting on what God had already done for them. When they came out of Egypt, God's presence was in a huge cloud that went before them during the day, and in a big pillar of fire that went through before them at night. God led them exactly where they needed to go. And not only that, God parted the sea and made a path for them to follow right through the middle of the sea. And here they were in the desert waiting and about to go into the promised land. And guess what? It wasn't going to be a cakewalk. There were still giants hanging around. There was still the big river to cross through. There were fortified cities and armies, and they were going to have to battle for 7 years. But guess who's going before them? The Lord. He wasn't going to leave them. He's going to be like Captain America with his big shield and fight the enemy while the army goes behind. He was leading them, and he was protecting them. And then I thought about that word forsake. And forsake, it's not a word you hear all the time, right? He will never leave you nor forsake you. I'm not going to go to work and say, hey, I forsake you, I'll see you later. It's not like that. We don't hear that word a lot. So forsake, it's a Hebrew word. It comes from Deuteronomy, Old Testament. So it means to leave, lose, forsake, to depart from, leave behind, leave let alone, neglect, forsake. And that part that said let alone really stood out to me. Our God will not leave you nor forsake you. Our God will not leave you alone. And so I started thinking about in our world today, how many people are lonely? And in this world of social media, you can be around a whole bunch of people and feel connected online. You can even be in a relationship. I can see those people sitting at the table texting instead of talking to each other. And I thought, how sad that we can live in a world with all these people, yet we can still feel lonely. So I started doing some research. And the latest statistics by the International Psychogeriatrics Journal, and this was published in 2018, and the San Diego Tribune took hold of it and put it online. It said 3 out of 4 Americans are lonely. And even though it was a small study done with about 340 people in the San Diego area, it said this could be applied to all of America. And it said how there were stages of loneliness, how when you're 20 and when you're 50 and when you're 80, you go through these stages of loneliness, and that it's a big deal, and the only way to get through that is to have wisdom. And so that kind of stuck out to me. It said, wisdom and loneliness don't seem to coexist, is what Jess said about this study. The study was done with 27-year-olds all the way up to 101-year-olds, and even though it says International Psychogeriatrics, none of them had mental health issues in this study. And then I got to thinking, so if you're lonely, you don't have wisdom, or if you have wisdom, you won't be lonely. And so their definition of lonely was, let me put on my granny glasses. It said qualities of wisdom or empathy, compassion, control over emotions, and self-reflection, which are really good qualities to have. But then I wanted to know what the Word of God said about it. And so I started looking at wisdom in the Word of God, and I saw James chapter 1, verse 5, and the Amplified says, if any of you lacks wisdom to guide him through a decision or circumstance, he is to ask of our benevolent God, who gives to everyone generously and without rebuke or blame, and it will be given to him. So wisdom, according to the Word of God, is guiding through a decision or circumstance. God sets that task before us, and he goes ahead of us.
He gives us wisdom when we ask, and all we have to do is let him lead us. And then I thought about, who is it that has wisdom, that has trusted God their whole lives? And David came to mind. And I looked and saw what David wrote about when he was talking about how the Lord guided him. And he said, the Lord is my shepherd. This is something most of us have been exposed to. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me. So, three things. The Lord is my shepherd. He calls the Lord a shepherd. He tells us that the Lord is the one who guides him. And he leads him through still waters, which are easy and calm. He guides us through the right paths. He doesn't take us down the wrong path. So he's always ahead of us, always leading us where we need to go, and we can trust in him because he's with us always. And then I thought about shepherds. And I thought about what it meant to be a shepherd during biblical times, because David called the Lord our shepherd. And in biblical times, shepherds really thought of their sheep as family. In fact, one of the articles I read said that if you blindfolded a shepherd, he would know each of his sheep by the sounds they made and by their feeling. You didn't even have to look at them. And that shepherds of biblical times used to play with their sheep, used to sleep with their sheep sometimes, and even though that was a really lowly position and kind of looked down upon back then, that they really served an important function. Sheep were, of course, part of sacrificial ceremonies. And the fatted tail was used for frying and all kinds of things. But what was really interesting to me was that in order to guide the sheep from one place to eat to another, in order to nourish them or to glean the harvest that was left over, the shepherd would, first of all, call to the sheep. He'd stand in the middle and he'd call to them, and then they all come running. And then he would stand in front of them to lead them. Because when I think about moving animals, I think of people on horses that kind of round them up and go around them and get them to go from being behind. But a shepherd leads them. He stands in front, and then they just follow wherever he wants to go. And even if he needs them to cross a stream, he calls to them and they follow him into the water. He goes first, they follow him into the water, and there's these sheep that are kind of love to be with the shepherd, so they stay with him always, so they jump right in behind him. And then the rest kind of follow because they don't want to be left alone. And then some get swept down the stream, and the shepherd grabs them and holds them and sometimes carries them to keep them safe. And then when they get to the other side, the sheep, the little ones, start jumping around like they're dancing. And then the older ones just gather around the shepherd like they're so thankful. And I thought, isn't that like our Lord? When we've kind of been swept away, he picks us up and carries us and loves on us to keep us safe. And I thought that was really, really cool. In fact, in 1 Peter, he calls us the flock of God. And he's speaking to the elders here, and he's telling the elders to keep take care of your sheep. And then he calls Jesus the chief shepherd, because Jesus is coming back one day and we'll get our glorious crowns. He calls Jesus the chief shepherd. And then he's talking to the younger people and saying, be humble. And he's telling us that there is an enemy out there, a roaring lion who wants to devour us, so beware. But I thought that was really neat that Jesus is our chief shepherd. And he loves us and he nourishes us with his word. And when he was here on earth, he constantly not only fed people physically with bread and fish, but he mainly
nourish their spirit. He would teach them the way to go. He would teach them a path to eternity. And he would make it easy and wouldn't lead them down the wrong path. And even when he had to leave and he went to go and sit at the right hand of the Father, he still protects us by making constant intercession for us. And then I also thought that wasn't that cool that when Jesus left us, he asked his Father to send somebody to be with us so we still wouldn't be alone. And that's the Holy Spirit. And in John 14:16 of the Amplified, it says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, a comforter, an advocate, an intercessor, a counselor, a strengthener, and a standby to be with you forever." God is always going to stand by us. And you have the Holy Spirit. He's with you wherever you go. But here's the deal. Sometimes we want a physical helper. And what's cool is God sends us shepherds in the form of pastors to be our physical helpers. He sends people to help carry us when we need it. And I looked up the word shepherd, and it comes from the Greek word, and it means of the feeder, protector, and ruler of a flock of men. So a shepherd is a ruler of a flock of men. And of course, you can use Google Translate for everything. So when I looked up what shepherd meant in Help's Word Study, it comes from the Latin word, which is pastor. And I thought that was really cool. So even in the Word of God, shepherd means pastor. And I thought about our pastors and how God uses them to nourish us with the Word of God and how they're always with us and they're studying and they're learning. And they have a passion for the Lord that they want to share with us. And how we can trust them to lead us in the right way, just like we could trust our sheep shepherd. And in fact, isn't it cool that God set it up that way? He had a plan for that. In Ephesians 11, it says, "And his gifts to the church were varied, and himself appointed some as apostles, special messengers, representatives, some as prophets who speak a new message from God to the people, some of evangelists who spread the good news of salvation, and some as pastors and teachers," which means to shepherd and guide and instruct. "And he did this to fully equip and perfect the saints, God's people, for the works of service, to build up the body of Christ, which is the church." So in order for us to be built up and to be unified as believers, he gave us shepherds to guide and lead us and to nourish us. And because I like Pastor Carey's story so much, I was like, "Please, Lord, give me a cute story that I can tell. She has such good stories." And God gave me an analogy instead. So, here goes. I don't know if it's because I'm just a teacher and I love summer, or whether it's just because, but he gave me the picture of a pool. And he showed me that around the pool, there are people sunbathing who get really hot sometimes, and they dip in the water and then they get out. And then if you look, there's kids playing with the volleyball, bouncing it back and forth, and there's kids swimming and learning to do their strokes in the lower end of the pool. And then you've got the hardcore guys right out there in the deep end, jumping off the diving board and doing tricks. And I said, "Okay, Lord, I see it. What does that mean?" And he said, "The water represents the Word of God. And the sunbathers around it are really the people who come on holidays or come when they have a need, and they come and they hear the Word of God for a minute, and then they're out. They really don't want any more of that." And then the people splashing in the water, and I saw Pastor AJ, and he was the guy who made the water fun for our teenagers. Oh, and they want to get into the Word of God, and they want to experience and learn more of the Word of God because Pastor AJ makes it fun to them. And it's still heavy meat he's giving them, but he does it in a way where they want to jump in the water and they want to stay there. And I'm thankful for that. And then I saw Pastor Joe over there. Pastor Joe is the guy who is taking the money for the pool memberships, and he's cleaning the pool, and he's jumping in to instruct when he needs to instruct. And he's the guy, when somebody forgets their towel, he runs to his car to give him his.
Amen.
And I'm thankful for that. And for your whole family. Whew. No emotion. All right. And so then he showed me Pastor Carrie. Pastor Carrie is a swim instructor. And she is the one coaxing people into the water to teach them to swim. And she's showing them the strokes, and she's showing them how to apply the Word of God to their lives. And she makes the water enjoyable, and people want to be in the water with her. And then they start going underwater, and she teaches them how to immerse for a while, and they pop up, and they want to hold their breath longer, and so they try harder to go and stay under the water longer and longer and longer. And pretty soon, they're ready for the deep end. And when you get to the deep end, who's there? Pastor Sean. And you feel like he's pushing you in. But what I love about Pastor Sean is what he really does is he holds your hands and he says, okay, we're ready to jump. You're ready for this. And he counts to three, and then you jump in together. And then once you're in there and you're treading water, Pastor Sean says, hey, let me give you the tools to use so that you can not only be in the deep end treading water, but you can immerse yourself. And here's a snorkel, and here's some goggles, so you can see and you can breathe underwater without having to come up. And that's how he treats the Word of God. He loves it. He loves to be in the deep end. He loves to pick words apart, and he loves to find the context, and he studies that so that we can learn what he knows. And his desire is for us to immerse ourselves in that deep end so that we can train others to swim. And I'm thankful for that. And so we are blessed with pastors who come from, who were called here. They didn't just grow up here. They were called here, and they answered God's call. And they didn't have to choose to come, but they did. And we have pastors who love us and want us to love others and to teach us how to do it, and I think. So if our pastors would come up, Pastor Carrie, Pastor Sean, Pastor Joe, Pastor AJ, and if our deacons would come up.
Tell Grace to come up too.
Thank you, Jackie. That was awesome.
message to us on Sundays, Wednesday nights with the youth, like AJ and Pastor Joe, everything you've done. You just stepped up the plate. I see, I know it can be tough, Pastor Sean, to kind of give you a nudge or, you know, he won't shove you, but he'll give you a nudge. he's growing you, brother, and I see it, and I'm very thankful for you and your family. You guys are awesome. And as a church, we just want to thank you guys for doing what you do. We can't thank you enough. Thank you.
So, I don't need to thank you. Now, I was thinking about this morning some of the fruit of the, you know, their work. And some of the young pastors and young shepherds and young teachers and evangelists and prophets and apostles that they're going to have a part of raising up and sending out to continue their work. That's fruit, and that's it's important. You know, a shepherd carries a rod, but it's not to hit the sheep; it's to hit the wolves, right? And their job is to protect and to guide and to lead. And can't think of a much more important job. It's kind of the day-to-day, grindy, dirty work that at the end of the day usually gets forgotten. But as sheep, when we look back, when we get older, we realize that you guys had a major impact in helping us get to where we're going. And, so we just want to honor you. And whose idea was this here? So I loved it back there. So we thought, you know, what better way to honor them than with a candy bar? You know, and it says you're the best, you know. So, you know, I know you probably could have used money, but we're like, who needs money? A candy bar is much better. You know?
Chocolate solves everything.
Yeah, and a big candy bar. So it's like, you're really good. So we just want to thank you. And one of the words that keeps going over and over and over and over in my mind and is, because I'm just starting out. I'm not even officially launched yet, but the Lord keeps reminding me, and I shared it with Pastor Joe last week, that our words and our wisdom should not be with the enticing words of men's wisdom, but in the power and in the demonstration of the Holy Spirit. That our wisdom should not reside in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. So we thank you that you guys know that, you believe that, and I thank you for encouraging us, sometimes with a shot in the shorts, sometimes with just a hug around the neck. We appreciate you, love you guys, and just want to honor you with a candy bar. Can everybody just stand with us, and we want to pray for them. Just stretch your hands towards them. And you know, as they have the responsibility for teaching us and helping us, and a lot of times encouraging us. And have you ever thought about who encourages them? So they need it too.
Amen.
So you know, as you think about them, just don't pray about them. Write them a little letter and drop it in, or send them an email or something, because It's a tough work. It's probably lonelier than most understand. You know, I think probably close friends is probably hard to come by. You know, so just stretch your hands towards them. We're just gonna pray, and then we're gonna go enjoy a meal together. So, Father, we just thank you so much, Lord, for sending us godly men and women to lead us, to help us, to encourage us, to hug us, to spend time with us, to eat lunch with us. Father, we just pray a rich blessing on you. Father, we thank you for blessing all the work of their hand. Father, we thank you that you're going to do exceedingly abundantly above all that they even ask, think, or imagine, according to the power that works inside you. Lord, we just thank you for rich, 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 abundant fruit for everything they endeavor to do. We thank you for revealing plan and purpose to them. And we thank you for courageous, strong will to fearlessly pursue. Lord, we just thank you. We bless their family. We bless their homes. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we just bless the food and we bless, just bless our time together as we go enjoy it together. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray, amen.
Amen.
So we invite everybody to come join us.
Woo! Hey, one thing, guys, one thing. I want to acknowledge Noelle. The first time I ever preached was at a pastor's appreciation service. She did an awesome job.
Yes. And
there's a lot